James Harrison, a largely unacknowledged but major contributor to the foundations of the city of Geelong, was a man of huge energy who seemed to be able to turn his hand to anything and everything. Who, for example, would know that Geelong can claim as one of its own the man who produced the world's first large-scale refrigeration machine in 1857? Or that James Harrison was the founder of the Geelong Advertiser, publishing its first edition in 1840? And as the paper's publisher and editor, that he was a vigorous and effective champion of the interests of the city and its region for the next 26 years. Born in Scotland in 1816, Harrison was only 12 when he began a printing apprenticeship in Glasgow, working 6 days a week, 12 hours a day. And after that 12-hour day, he went at night to the Glasgow Mechanics Institute, where he developed the literary and inventive skills that served his broad and diverse future career.
He arrived here in 1837 and landed in Sydney, and he worked there for the Sydney Morning Herald and two or three papers.
Melbourne, the newly named settlement on the Yarra, was only 4 years old when Harrison moved there in 1839. The town's population then numbered around 3,000. And there were about another 2,000 people living in the Geelong-Portland region.
He went down there to start the newspaper for John Pascoe Fawkner. But John had sold him a very old press, which he called a load of rubbish. And but within 12 months, my grandfather owned the Advertiser and ran it for 26 years, I think.
The 1851 discovery of gold in Victoria brought dramatic changes across all regions. But the increased demand from the gold rush had been a boost for primary industry in the Geelong region. It had expanded down the Bellarine Peninsula and now produced more than the region could utilise. Farmers were looking for new markets.
Well, I guess as a publisher and as an editor of a paper, he was very aware of the fact that Australia had a lot of primary produce, but we couldn't export it due to the fact that they couldn't keep it on the long journey. He got to thinking of what could be done. And, of course, as a printer, he had to keep the type clean, and he used sulfuric ether to clean the type, and he found that made his fingers very cold, and when he blew on the type, there were ice crystals formed.
He learned from failures in the prototypes of other inventors, and through his own, sometimes explosive, experimentation in a cave at Rocky Point. In 1857, he became the first person in the world to design, patent, and manufacture a machine that actually made ice.
Yes, his first experimental machines worked on compression and evaporation, and that he never varied from that. And the refrigerator in your kitchen today still works on basically that principle. Colonial engineering was pretty simple at that stage, so he went to England to seek out the help of steam engineers, which he did, and that was when he went to Seber and Company.
While in England, he had two large machines built, one for a paraffin works and the other for a brewery. These were the first large and successful refrigerating machines to be sold.
When he went to England, he had left the business in the charge of his brother. And his brother, not hearing anything of success or otherwise, assumed that there had been success, and he built a new printing office and so forth and so forth. And, of course, James came back without too much money because he had hoped to sell his patents in England, which he didn't.
Harrison arrived back in Geelong in November 1858 and immediately directed his energies into the production of ice. Within 3 months, his machine was in full operation in a not yet completed building on the corner of Victoria and Latrobe Terraces. Later, to encourage consumers, Harrison offered domestic ice chests at cost price. Unfortunately, the public was slow to take up the home refrigeration idea, and they didn't like the frosty whiteness of the artificial ice. Harrison took on a massive campaign to promote the uses and virtues of ice, but the public remained reticent, and business was slow. At the same time, Harrison's debts from his commitments in the production of ice-making machines continued to mount. In October 1861, the Geelong Advertiser included James Harrison as one of 71 cases listed for the insolvency court. But Harrison was not a man easily beaten. For the next phase of his determined career, he relocated to Melbourne, where he was employed as a journalist and editor with the Melbourne Age. And his passion to prove the worth of refrigeration in the service of agricultural export markets was still just as keen. His solution was to build the forerunner of modern refrigerated containers.
He pre-froze tons of meat and put inside these containers and then covered them over with many, many more tons of ice. And he had a circulating system to circulate brine into the containers. Somewhere as they were going around Africa, the containers broke down and let water into the insulation, which ruins its quality or its purpose as an insulator. And the whole lot had to be thrown overboard. So he arrived in England a broken man. He spent many years, nearly 20 years in England, preparing further patents on the improvements of refrigeration and particularly on containers. And he came back in 1892, mainly because I think probably his youngest son had consumption, and he brought him back for health-wise, and he died. And then, of course, a year later, Grandpa died of the same problem.
James Harrison died in 1893. The Geelong community paid for his gravestone at the East Geelong Cemetery.
He died at Point Henry. He used to write articles for The Age. All the time he was in England, he reported to The Age. He was dictating one of those to my Auntie Queenie, who was his second daughter of the third marriage, when he died.